You're listening to Nakedly Examined Music, a podcast about songs and songwriters. My name is Mark Lintonmeyer. My guest for episode 105 is Wayne Hussey, best known as the leader of the long-running band The Mission, or as is known in the States, The Mission UK. But he started out in the late 70s, and part of my prep for this was to read his new autobiography, Salad Days, where he talks about playing with Pauline Murray and the Invisible Girls, being there during the formative period of Dead or Alive, who later had a very big hit without him. And what you're hearing right now is Marianne by the Sisters of Mercy from the First, Last, and Always album, 1985. That was a band where he is not the singer, but he wrote and arranged all these guitar parts and figured out how to do the thing that he would then go on to do in The Mission, along with the Sisters of Mercy bassist Craig Adams, plus another guitarist, Simon Hinkler. So he's since put out 11 albums with The Mission, plus two solo albums and some collaborations. We're going to be talking today first about one of Wayne's solo tunes. It's very much in The Mission style. The song is called Wither on the Vine. It's from his Songs of Candlelight and Razor Blades album in 2014. Then we'll look to the final, as of this moment, Mission album. The song is called Phantom Pain from 2016's Another Fall from Grace. Then we'll look back to the heyday of The Mission with Tower of Strength from the album Children, 1987. Now, all the early Mission songs, for business purposes, were designated as groove written, so that included the drummer Mick Brown, and I should say the producer and keyboardist on that song was the Led Zeppelin bassist John Paul Jones. We're going to conclude by listening to another solo tune, a 2016 single, My Love Will Protect You. For more information, check out themissionuk.com. For more about this podcast, please see nakedlyexaminedmusic.com, and if you appreciate what we're doing, you can make that known by signing up for some recurring support at patreon.com/nakedlyexaminedmusic. Now, before I get going with Wayne, I want to stop and do a sponsor break. And this is not an ordinary sponsor break that you would want to fast forward over. This is Masterclass, which is very much like what you get out of this podcast, except you get more time with the person. And these are like world historic figures. Some of the greatest living writers, directors, actors, sports personalities, business folks. You can learn cooking from Gordon Ramsay, tennis from Serena Williams, photography from Annie Leibovitz, and within the entertainment area, there's Steve Martin, there's Penn and Teller, and with music in particular, they hit country music with Reba McEntire, Usher, Deadmau5, Timbaland, Itzhak Perlman teaching violin, Hans Zimmer teaching film scoring. Last time I did one of these ads, I talked to you about the Herbie Hancock jazz course, which was amazing. This time, I immersed myself in Carlos Santana teaches the art and soul of guitar. And you might notice on this podcast that a lot of times my interviewees will answer a question by just saying, yeah, that's just, it was an intuitive decision. That's just how it worked. I surrendered myself to the music. And I accept that as an answer, but Carlos actually knows how to explain what that means. So what I like about these courses is that the instruction takes place at both a very general and a very specific level. So if you don't play guitar, if you're not even a performer at all, you're going to still get something out of this. You're going to still find it inspirational. For instance, the second lecture, Practice as a Musical Offering. Carlos goes into inspirational detail about how to make practice not drudgery. He talks about practice as just going for a walk. You don't know where you're going to end up. So he'll say something very general like that, but then he'll show you very specifically, this is the kind of warm-up that I do when I have been playing for a while. And often there will be a on-screen caption, you know, tab 2, that will say, go look at the downloadable PDF for this course, which is very elaborate. And each of these lectures has a discussion section. It's all these other people watching this, commenting on specific things they're finding helpful, places where they disagree, and they're adding new features like labs to give you even better ways of interacting with it, of remembering things after the fact. So I highly recommend you check it out. Get unlimited access to every masterclass, and as a Nakedly Examined Music listener, you get 15% off the annual All Access Pass. Go to masterclass.com/examined. That's masterclass.com/examined for 15% off masterclass. All right, so here's my interview with Wayne Hussey. So I will have played a little Marianne from Sisters of Mercy from First and Last and Always, 1985. Given your book, Salad Days, I guess I didn't realize, well, it stopped before you actually got to The Mission. I was sad that I did not get to read. Is there going to be a volume 2 sometime to that?
Yes, I hope so. When I was writing the book, I'd actually gotten to the first year or so, 6 or 7 chapters into The Mission. It was already quite a lengthy amount of words, and so somebody suggested to me that maybe we should finish the book when I leave the sisters and then maybe write another book about The Mission years. Omnibus Press want to do it. You know, I've actually signed a contract to do it. So I guess I will do it at some point. I enjoyed the process of writing, actually.
I feel like the Sisters of Mercy and the Mission kind of made their way over to the U.S. in equal portions, at least as far as I could tell. I didn't go to college until 89, so I was a little after. I don't know what the buzz was at the time these things came out, but certainly reading your preemptive defenses against critics of your role in Sisters of Mercy, you recognize that that first Sisters of Mercy album, that not only I was pleased to see that you took a great deal of still pride and ownership in that and your work on that, that it wasn't just, oh, you know, a thing that I did before my solo band took off, but that it was just considered so seminal by critics. So it's nice to give it that emphasis that you did.
Yeah, but you know, at the time of release, it wasn't viewed that way at all. I mean, obviously, we got some good reviews and we got some not so good reviews. Quite often with seminal albums, that's the way it works. It's only history that bestows that accolade of being seminal on an album. You know, at the time, it wasn't seen as that at all. It's something I'm proud of, but I'm proud of pretty much everything I've been involved in, to be honest. It's one of those albums that everything else I've ever done since kind of gets judged against, I guess, which is a little unfair sometimes, but that's the way things are.
Well, I guess you're working out some of your techniques in terms of guitar layering and things. Let's get to more or less the modern period. Wither on the Vine is one that I chose. So it's from Songs of Candlelight and Razor Blades 2014, a solo album, but it still sounds very much prime period Mission. This could have been something theoretically that would not be terribly out of place, you know, in a 1990 album or something, but that many extra years experience and of course the sonic improvements available. So it's just a really nice sonic update of that classic sound. I thought this was a good representative of your body of work as a whole. If folks need something to introduce them.
Songs of Candlelight and Razor Blades. I mean, think about this. That actually came about a year or so after the Mission album, The Brightest Light. And I'd written a whole bunch of songs for The Brightest Light. And there were quite a few left over. So I thought a year later, well, I'm going to make a solo record with the songs that I had left over. But I also needed to write one or two more. And during the course of The Brightest Light, I'd written a song called Swan Song and recorded it as a band. But we also ended up releasing that as a single. And whilst we released that as a single, we needed extra versions of it. So I recorded a new version of it with a drum machine. I kind of redid everything, you know, a totally different vibe. But it worked really well for me. And so when I did Songs from Candlelight and Razor Blades, I recorded the songs I already had, but I also needed two or three new ones. So I had the idea of doing something that sounded of that ilk, you know, with a drum machine, with that rolling bass line thing. So, you know, Wither in the Vine was a little, if I say contrived, it sounds bad, but it was a little contrived in as much as I wanted it to sound a particular way.
Their words my God above. The tongue I use for speaking my mind, or the flag I stand behind, the screaming shout and crying wail. But in the end, well, it's heaven or hell. I read their words to spite and scorn. I live by the creed to which I'm sworn. I know the sky is ripped and torn. I'll die the death to which I'm
Let's just talk about your sonic creation here, just right from the beginning. You've got this delay guitar, and then you come in on, well, it seems like there's also delay on your rhythm guitar. It's a well-delivered package that sets you up for the main riff that...
The way that I play guitar and the sounds that I always kind of gravitate towards are chorused, flanged, phased, delayed. That's what I like to play with. I'm not one for big heavy chords or chugging or that kind of thing. Most of the time when I'm recording, I don't usually have too much of an idea of what I'm going to do. And so I will record things and have then come back to it later with view to playing it live and have no idea what I played. So I have to sit down and try and work out quite often exactly what I played. Sometimes that's quite problematic, particularly some songs where I use unusual tunings, and it's like, what the hell did I do? I have taken to recording pieces of music that I think, okay, well, I'm going to struggle to remember this later. I have recorded it to on camera, playing it so that, you know, remind me. Wither on the Vine, I mean, basically, I probably started with the drum machine and then the basic guitar part and then the bass line and then layered some more guitar parts on the top of it. And then I thought, okay, it needs another section. Let's move it here. And then we need a middle bit. How about a guitar solo? In the old days, when we didn't have the luxury of being able to record at home, or I didn't have the luxury of my own studio, we would rehearse songs. I would demo them on a four-track studio with a little drum machine and take them to the band. We would rehearse the songs first, and then we would go to a demo studio and put them down as a band, usually live, and then use that as a demo for when we went into the studio proper to record it. Nowadays, I don't bother with demos. Just go straight to recording, and in my mind, it's going to be the, you know, what I'm doing will end up being the finished master. I think that's a lot of people approach recording music now that way because we can.
So, do you remember in that initial wash there? I'm hearing two distinct, you know, you've got the da 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 da, and you've got the melody guitar. I'm also hearing something that's filling in the gaps, you know, that's providing some backing, sort of where the keyboard would be. Are you the kind that will put the third or the fourth guitar to kind of thicken things up? I know you're very minimalist in the amount of notes, but in terms of the actual texturing.
I will texture things quite a lot if I feel it needs it. I will definitely double up parts and or even triple parts, you know, with different sounds, just to give it a different texture. And dynamically as well, you know, so you leave certain guitars out and then you bring them back in for the bridges or whatever. I mean, without sitting here and listening to it and analyzing it that way, I really can't remember what I did on the recording. And that's the point I was making before. When I'm in the moment, you know, you surrender to that moment and you surrender to that moment being creative and you go with the flow. As I said, quite often, I can't remember what I did. I mean, I listen to Marianne now by the Sisters of Mercy. And I know that I did all that in the space of just a few hours, the whole track from start to finish, writing it and all, and put the whole thing together. And there's some kind of alchemy at work there because the way everything fits together sonically is just, to my mind, in my ears, it's like, wow. And I love records where you listen to them and you're not quite sure what is doing what.
Yeah.
You have this sound and you think, okay, I know there's some guitars in there. I know there's this and I can hear that going on. But the actual composite parts are very difficult to kind of ascertain.
I know you're very into the mixing process. So you can spend a lot of time with the reverb and thing to try to make the guitars just melt into each other. So you just have no idea, is this a thickener? You actually mentioned in your book that you use auto harp sometimes to thicken the guitar. That's a crazy, I'd never heard of that technique.
I mean, I do have an auto harp. I've had an auto harp for years. I used it on the Sisters of Mercy album. I used it actually for the first time, I think, with Dead or Alive. It's a little trick I learned over the years. I mean, the conventional way of using an auto harp is that you strum the chord. You know, you press your finger down on the bar that's got the chord name on it. You know, okay, that's an A minor. Put that down, you strum it. That's an A minor. Then you go to F. Okay, that. What I do is actually tune the strings up to maybe a chord that's, you know, in the song and then pick out the notes. And it works really well tucked in. I mean, there are a couple of places where you can hear it for sure on the Sisters album.
Let me play one little bit for you about 2 minutes and 20 seconds in where the intro guitar riff has come back and there's this kind of swirling something that gets you into the third verse. So if we can figure out what this is or... So it all sounds like two layers that you're doing this, and then there's an extra one. Is this like reverse reverb or?
It's a vocal scream, actually. It's a scream, put delay on, flange it and phase it and whatever. It just becomes part of the composite sound, I suppose. Rather than just have the guitar again repeating what it's already done, there's an additional sound to differentiate that part from the previous part.
Or have a drum riff that would have to accelerate through this. This allows you to get that momentum without bringing in the heavy guns, let's say.
If there was a real drummer playing that, I'm sure there would be a big heavy roll with loads of cymbals on it, which, you know, I'm not averse to occasionally, but I prefer my drummers to use their tom-toms rather than their cymbals.
Yeah, one of the things I like best about the way you get into it originally is that initial hi-hat riff right before the actual thing comes in.
Yeah, Bit disco.
Yes, yes. That gives it a little disco groove. I mean, how intrusive do you feel you can get with your drummers in terms of, yes, this is the riff that I wrote for this part. Please do that or come up with something better.
The beauty of being the main songwriter in the band, you know, for 30 odd years is that I can go into the band and say, this is exactly how it goes. I want the drums to do this. The bass line does this, whatever. There's two guitar parts. One does this and one does that. Work out what's best for us to play. On the other hand, I can go in with really sketchy. I've got, you know, a few chords here. I'm not really sure what to do with. Let's jam around on them for a little while. Obviously, you need space and time and a band that's willing to work like that. I mean, that's really the way that the mission has operated for the last 30 odd years. So
thematically, it's really interesting to read your book, to hear about your very heavy Mormon background, but your rejection of that. Of course, if you're raised in that kind of environment, it sinks into your subconscious so that you're using, I mean, just the name, the mission. There's a lot of biblical imagery in a lot of your songs because you've kind of got that to draw on. And Wither from the Vine specifically, like I looked up, just did a quick Bible search. What is the wither on the vine? I mean, is this just the idea being sort of a variation of the better to burn out than to fade away? That, in other words, I'm going to keep being productive, whatever my public image happens to be. I know you don't like to interpret your lyrics exactly, but.
You know, again, it's one of those things. I mean, I write the lyrics and at the time I kind of surrender to the creative process. Particularly with this song, I think each verse meant something different to me. But then at the end of it, I mean, I think it's actually lyrically, it's quite an important little message there, actually. You know, it's a song about tolerance, really. And in the current state of the world, I think it's quite pertinent. It's, you know, asking for tolerance for the way that we live our lives, you know, for being different, for clothes we wear, the length of our hair, who we love and how we love. And, you know, our beliefs, our religious beliefs, our spiritual beliefs and stuff. It seems to me that politically in the world, we've taken a huge step backwards in the last 5 or 6 years, I think.
Do you think about when you write lyrics of what the narrative object, I'm not sure if there's a technical term for this, but in other words, sometimes you write a song that is singing to a specific person. Sometimes you write it kind of singing to the audience in mass. And it sort of seems to change during this song that, you know, when you're saying, don't judge me, that's kind of a speaking to the crowd, but presumably you don't want the crowd to take you in its arms, you know, at least not, it seems it gets more personal at that point.
I mean, you say that, but something like this, the song Tower of Strength, there's a song, it's a mission anthem that's become quite the moment of commune between us and the audience when we play it. And it's a song that I wrote for the audience back in the day when I was, you know, I was feeling particularly blue one day and somebody said to me, you know, I was thinking about packing it in, whether I had it in me to be the singer and the front man. And, you know, a close friend said, well, look at all the people that love you. You know, you're a tower of strength to them. So I kind of wrote the song for them, the audience. But I also was very aware of trying to write it to a solitary person rather than, you know, a host of people. It's become a song that's, in many ways, it defines what the mission are. I think this Tower of Strength is a song. And I think Wither on the Vine has elements of that as well. It's a singular person, but at the same time, it has that big audience thing going on as well.
Well, and it's got that same soaring, I read the words, you know, of course, you're talking about your wings taking heavenly flight and stuff. So it's got that lofty sermon-like, I guess, or declaratory speech-like character to it.
Someone say sermon because that sounds a bit preachy, but yeah, I know what you mean. It's a tad evangelical.
It's an interesting mix of the personal that it seems like you're talking about your image in the press or something, the words of spite and scorn, or at least I'm reading this into based on what you've said in your book.
Yeah, it's not just the press. Everybody has access to online forums and Twitter and Instagram and the rest of it. People can go online and they can say what they want about me and about the band or whatever. And of course, we have the right to reply. But if we do, I think you just get embroiled in this toxicity. I want to avoid that. The thing is, I've read some really nasty things out there about me and about other people. It's not just me. You know, anybody that's in the public domain has to contend with this to some degree at some point.
So I like the response to that being sort of this open-hearted, philosophical, we're all going to die. I'll just live by my creed the best I can.
I don't sit down, particularly recently, actually, in the last, 10 years. I don't sit there and work the lyrics. Mostly they come. And if they don't come, then I leave them until, I come back to them when I feel like doing it. And then they come. It's not something I will sit there and work and deliberate over for days and days. I would do that when I was younger, when the songs, conversely, probably meant less. I guess that was also a symptom of being quite a heavy drug user at the time.
Has it still been the case that, as when you weren't even writing the lyrics in Sisters of Mercy, that the lyrics always come last, or are there plenty of these songs that at least part of the lyrics comes first and then you sit down with the guitar?
There's no set rules. Typically, it's usually I write the music first and then I have a vague idea of a melody. Then I will sit down and try and find words to fit that melody. But there have been occasions where I've sat down with the guitar and come up with the whole thing, vocal, melody, lyric, and the basic chords all in one go. Other times, I'll be driving or whatever, and a lyric will come into my mind and I'll record it on my phone, and then that will be the starting point for a song. There are no hard and fast rules. Again, it's a creative process, and if you're open to that creative process, songs can come in many forms.
Sure, I do see a correlation from folks I've talked to or my own work between if you write music first, then it becomes a puzzle. Sometimes, like, you can still just spout off and the lyrics come immediately, but very often, like, what's actually going to fit this? Whereas if the lyric is the initial inspiration, then usually, well, it's a whole more or less well-formed idea. And so the lyrics might come faster if they come first.
You're right. When you sit down to write a lyric to a song and a melody that's already there and established, it is like a puzzle. You have to find the rhythm and the meter of it. And quite often I make life difficult for myself because I don't know what the technical term is, but I will have a double rhyme in a line, in a couple of lines, So once that's established, it's like, okay, then you have to follow that for the rest of the song. It's a bit of a cross to bear.
Well, let's get the second song out there. Probably a bleaker day when you wrote this, Phantom Pain by The Mission from Another Fall from Grace 2016.
It's quite possibly my favorite track on that album. Although I think the album as a whole is as strong as anything The Mission have ever done. And Phantom Pain is the last one. I mean, it's not really a song about me. I've written it in the first person, but it's a song that was born out of conversation with friends of mine that were all diagnosed with depression. The largest demographic for people diagnosed with depression are actually white males between the age of 41 and 59. I think it's quite obvious why, because you have that first flush of youth and energy, and then you go out into the world and you try to establish who you are, what your place in the world is. And once you've kind of done that, it's kind of like, okay, what else is there? So I can understand that, and it kind of feels quite often, I think, that we've achieved what we set out to achieve quite early on. So once you've done that, it's like, what else is there? So that's why I think some people obviously become depressed by that. Others turn to religion. Others, start hiking or climbing mountains, I have, some very high-profile friends who were multimillionaires and seemingly have everything that they ever wanted, ever desired in life, yet they've been diagnosed depressives for years, taking antidepressants. And it was a song, really, that was born out of those conversations. There have been a couple of times in my life where I was diagnosed with depression, and so I was on medication for it. But I got to the point both times where I did want to become dependent on the medication. So once I kind of maybe took the medication for 6-9 months, and once I kind of got myself straightened out a little bit, I came off it. Depression's a weird one because it's not always evident why it comes on.
Back on the chemicals again.
so tedious and mundane. I have everything I've ever wanted, so I don't know why. Sometimes there are days when all I wanna do is die.
Thank you.
phantom pain.
So it is nice that you have the experience to be able to write these lyrics and channel this mood, but we're not in that state when you're doing it, so that you could still have a just meticulously arranged. I love the changes of energy in this, and this definitely jumped out to me. Yeah, do you want to say a little about we again start with a funky little drum machine, even though you have the real drummer in this band, but let's start with that anyway, with this kind of electronic bongo thing.
It was my attempt really to kind of emulate Massive Attack. I'm a big fan of Massive Attack. I wanted to capture the mood of some of their records with this one. So that was where the rhythm track came from. The guitar part was kind of inspired by a Sisters of Mercy song that I recorded when I was in the band called After Hours, which was a B-side. To me, it was one of my favorite Sisters songs. I kind of stole that idea and developed it a little bit more. And then there's the bit in the middle where I got Duke Garwood to play, I think it was bassoon. And his brief was, make it insane. And he did a fantastic job, I have to say. I mean, for me, that transforms the song into something that's, well, transcendent for me. Elevates it, you know, above and beyond anything else that the Mission have ever done in that sense.
Yeah, both these songs we've played have been on the long side compared to the majority of your work. And the first one, you know, it's not a fast, Wither on the Vine is not a particularly fast song. There's guitar things that need to resolve.
I think Wither on the Vine is 120 BPM, which is the...
The default, yes.
Yeah, the default, yeah. So I think that's... I'm just like, oh yeah, that'll do.
It doesn't seem like it's overstuffed. You know, like Tower of Strength that we're going to get to, there's a definite point at which, okay, now we're vamping. Like this could have been, and in fact, you have a radio edit, of course, of it. This could have been quite a bit shorter. So Phantom Pain has a similar thing that I think it's really because of that bassoon and or saxophone stuff that's going on there that, oh, we've created this new environmental element. We can definitely get 2 extra minutes out of this because that is just so cool, apart from the actual content of the song.
Yeah, every song is different. You know, I mean, we have done songs that are less than 2 minutes. Also, I'm certainly not averse to making songs long if the song itself warrants it. If and when you have to consider these songs for singles or for radio, then it's like, okay, then we will consider that after. It's not something I considered before. This just feels right at this length. It's not a fail-safe way of method of doing it, for sure. I mean, there have been times when we have overstayed our welcome with certain songs, but, you know, experience teaches you when to shorten something or when something can be lengthened.
Yeah, well, for the finale of the album, especially, like, you could make this 20 minutes and it would still be okay because it's the end of the album.
Yeah, well, also you just get that groove and it's just, okay, it just sits there. It's not particularly dynamic piece, but it has its mood. And if you're in that mood, I don't know about you, but I love, if I'm in a particular mood, then I love long pieces of music that match that mood.
You're talking about the mood. Is this pretty much the bottom of your vocal range?
That's my first thing in the morning voice. I did try singing it later in the day at first and then late at night, but it just wasn't there, you know. So it was, okay, I'm going to try this first thing in the morning. Wake up, go straight into the studio and do the vocal, which is what I did before my voice started going, you know, before the coffee and before the day takes its toll. That's the only way that I found that I could do that vocal. It's first thing in the morning. Hence, we will never play it live.
Even the chord progression that E, you're at the bottom of the guitar, and then it has to have some movement. So, well, let's move it just up to F, and then falls back down immediately. You know, that's the first, like, the weight of gravity on this thing as a whole is great. That, the fact that the bass, I assume the bass is actually playing eighth notes, but you've engineered it so that it just sounds like a wash. It sounds a rumbling rather than, like, distinct notes.
I actually think I used the bass sample for part of it as well. So that may be mixed in with the bass guitar. That does become more washy. It's not something I kind of think about too much whilst I'm doing it. I just do it, and it's instinct. It takes over. You're in the moment, as I said before, and you surrender to it.
Let me play a little bit this middle part about 2 minutes in. You've got this interesting and very spatially removed guitar riff at the beginning. Between the verses, you have a new riff that comes in. The early one is way in the back to the left side. This one is more to the right side, and it doesn't come in where you'd expect. You know, it comes on the one the first time, but it actually comes in a little early the second time. So just having that, you know, that it's da-da-da-dun-da-dum, and it doesn't just wait, da-da-da-dun, like, you know, coming in on the three or something. Is that just purely intuitive at the time?
Purely intuitive. That's just what felt right to me. And then when I started playing it and then looking at it against the grid, it was like, look, oh, that's a little odd. But for me, it sounded right. So I just kept it.
Well, it gives you then room to bring back the initial riff at the end of that section and a rain stick.
Yeah, it's a rain stick my wife bought me for Christmas 1 year. So I had to use it on something.
Well, and that sets up really well. So when the chorus actually does come in, I was noticing this drum sound.
Sometimes it feels like the night will never end.
This big is, I guess, reverse reverb on the snare. It just sounds wet.
You know what that is? I was in the car one day when my wife was driving. I had a plastic bag on my lap. I can't remember if what was in it. Maybe we'd just been shopping. And there was a track on the stereo, on the car stereo. And I was pulling the plastic bag up and down with the snare. And it was like, oh, that, I like that. I basically took the plastic bag, just normal plastic bag from the store, into the studio, and I added that to the snare. So where the snare played, I would go, pull the plastic bag and push it back down.
Well, let's focus in just a little bit on these little, I wrote saxophone breaks, but you're saying bassoon, right?
Yeah, I think it's a bass bassoon, actually.
So you've got the bassoon over the percussion, some light guitar, and it sounds like some like xylophone synth sounds. Yeah, there's some interesting little extra texture here. So these little bling, blong, these little things that are going over that to kind of...
Yeah, it's guitar that's, you know, made to sound not like a guitar. I mean, there's already guitars there, so it was okay.
With the octaver or something, the adding the little...
No, I can't really remember. It was actually, it's Simon. I sent the track to Simon, and that was one of the things he came back with.
We should talk about that. I've never really been clear. I don't even know that seeing a live show would reveal this in terms of like, what are you contributing versus what is Simon contributing on a song like this?
Basically, the whole track is written and recorded by me. And I played the bass on this, not Craig. So Craig didn't need to be involved. Mike, the drummer, I think I'm not sure if he played anything on this. Maybe there's a couple of little percussion bits he might have done.
Oh, so even the main drum part is drum machine still?
It's still drum machine, yeah. Programmed drums. There's the drum machine that sounds like a drum machine, and there's drums that sound like a drummer. And then I sent it to Simon, and he would have just then added little bits. I mean, there are a couple of little high bits he added in that don't particularly sound like guitar, which are lovely. You know, he sends me a bunch of stuff, and I edit it how I see fit.
No, I like that approach that it's not, I mean, of course, in a live setting... You have to be able to do it. So dividing it up in terms of, so you're not singing while playing stuff that's too hard or whatever.
When we're recording, we approach it as a recording. And when we play it live, we have to think about it differently.
Letting folks add whatever they're most, however you can draw best on their creativity. And if that means not that much for the song or just the frosting, like that's great. There's always room for more ideas for the frosting.
And then I think Julianne Reagan sings some backing vocals on.
Yes, those beautiful, thick.
She's fantastic. She's brilliant. when she first sent her vocals back to me, it was quite interesting because she tried to put a positive spin lyrically on the choruses. I can't remember exactly what she sang, but it was her idea was that, well, you know, I just thought it'd be nice to have a positive spin on the lyrics in the end, you know, so you go through all of this and at the end it's, you know, it comes out positive. It didn't really tally with how I saw the song, you know, and ultimately I get the final say on this occasion anyway.
So I feel nothing about all but Phantom Pain, but it's okay. It's okay. So I'm kind of answering.
Yeah. But it's okay. Yeah. But it'll pass. Or yes, I can't remember exactly what it was, but
yeah.
Which I heartily endorse on most occasions. But on this one, it just felt like me. It was a bit superfluous.
Yeah, well, if you're going to add in the voice of an angel, it is tempting to have it say something angelic rather than just...
It's funny, though. I mean, this is a song, as I said before, this is a song that probably provoked the most reaction on that album in terms of people from comments and stuff and messages I've received since its release.
Before we move on to the last song, let me ask you one really nerdy mixing question. So I can't live this masquerade no more. I've been in mixing sessions where we've gone through and systematically taken all the breaths and either remove them or move them down. But here, like it really, it's a sigh of despair.
I like breaths. You can overdo it, of course, but there have been occasions where I've definitely pushed the breath, put echo on it. So it just becomes a feature.
You were talking about before about, you know, using it as a sound effect. I love doing that kind of stuff because like you think melodies with your head, with your mouth. So if you can actually get the sound with enough effects so that doesn't sound like you just humming or whatever it is into the track.
I personally think that, you know, when you hear breathing like that or deep breaths, there's something quite sensual about it too.
Sure. That's interesting that this is a depression song, but the line between singing low depressed and singing low sultry is like, it's thinner than one might think.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Last one we're going to talk about at any detail. I'm sure you've talked about this to death before, but I just couldn't resist picking Tower of Strength from The Mission from the Children album 1987. I know this is one of your favorite songs by the band that you still play live. We've already brought it up today. Do you want to say a little about it before it appears in full?
If there's one song that epitomizes all the great things about The Mission, then it's got to be Tower of Strength. You know, it's big, it's grand, it's bombastic, it's the grand gesture, it's the song that's communal, you know, between us and our audience. It's that moment every night that I look forward to when we play live. There's something that really happens between us and the audience with this song. It started off with an easy guitar riff that I came up with against a little drum machine, and it became this mega monster roller coaster of a thing, you know, with John Paul Jones' involvement in it as well, doing all the string parts. It captured a moment.
All right. 8 minutes long. Folks can prepare.
Eight minutes and 8 seconds, in fact.
Yep. Here it is.
To feel no one ever cared.
Yes, actually a very aggressive. Do you forego the drum machine loop when you play it live now that you just have the kit do something, or are you working with backing tracks?
No, we use a backing track all through it with that loop, and I think we got the strings on the backing track.
Yeah, you might as well if you're using it.
Yeah, and some acoustic guitars. I mean, I double up the acoustic live. But and then when the drums come in, the real drums come in, you know, so we play along to it. The bass is played live and Simon plays all the guitar parts live. I sing live, of course, too.
And so is this one a, you know, that you're doing the 12 string and Simon is doing the solos here? That, you know, there are like three different solo breaks here.
All the solos on this are Simon. It probably ranks amongst his very, very best work, I think, with the band. The thing about the Mission, really, if you listen to the records, if you know, then you'll recognize that most of the bread and butter guitar lines that the songs are based around are usually mine. The riffs and the basic chord structures. And I mean, I don't really play a lot of chords. I play a lot of arpeggios and things like that, you know. So most of that, 90%, is probably mine. But most of the guitar solos and the lead lines are Simon's.
So what about when the synth really takes over and kind of puts out its own lead line? This could be the outro right now. I mean, that's such a great...
That's John Paul Jones. Okay. The guy that played bass in Led Zeppelin and played all those brilliant keyboard parts for them. We had him there in the studio and it was quite... I have to look back in it now and think, wow. But I remember because he was sat there playing the keyboard and playing the samples, the string samples. And I was sat in his chair, the producer's chair, saying, "It's not quite right, you know, John. I think you could do better." And then it's like, "My God, I'm saying you could do better to John Paul Jones from Led Zeppelin." But the stuff he came up with is awesome. You're absolutely awesome. You know, I mean, it's an element of the song that it's became integral. It's got that sweep. It's got that grandness.
So what about just something like the main dun 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 dun? That propels it through much of the song. Was that a group thing? Is that a Craig thing? Or
that was me from a demo thing. I mean, basically, you know, I wrote that bass line and it was like I came up with the guitar line first, basic. I came up with that and recorded that to the little drum machine. And the drum machine that we used at the beginning of this is actually this very same drum machine pattern that I came up with when I did the demo. We liked it so much, we kept it, and the same drum machine. I can't remember what it was now, but it was a cheap Roland. And the bass line is just, you know, I wanted something that just stayed there whilst the chords did the harmonic work. And the bass just kind of stayed there, just kind of propelled it.
So this sounds like the one that was more or less, you know, you had your demo. So was the demo 3 minutes, or was it, like, did this really become what it is in the studio?
Yeah, I mean, it became what it was in rehearsal. I mean, the demo was probably, I don't know, 3-4 minutes, as you say. It had all the parts, the basic sections. Obviously, we enhanced them and extended them in rehearsal. It's one of those things, we get into the groove and it's like, okay, this just feels fun and good to play. So let's keep playing it.
Did this seems like, I'm just trying to think of this in comparison to your previous melodies with the Mission, you know, that it's a very... long sustained, just your chorus. You're being very confident with your voice at this point, right? to me, you know, that's the whole thing is it's focusing on this almost Arabian sounding, occasionally even flitting around, you know, with that little Arabian trill, very forefront. Was that like double tracked in the studio?
Yeah, I'm sure it was double tracked in the studio.
Does this feel weird to have this that upfront, or was that, you know, already established in past Mission songs that you're not singing low Sisters of Mercy, Joy Division sort of groan, you're going to really bust it?
Yeah, no, I think by that point I would, you know, I'd become confident in my voice. I mean, definitely when the Mission started, I wasn't. I kind of got the job really by default. When Craig and I formed the band, we had every intention of finding another singer, but circumstances prevented that. And I ended up becoming the singer really by default. It could have been Craig, except I'm, you know, we decided it should be me because I was better looking. So it's always better to have the lead singer as the better looking one rather than the bass player. This is the second album. By that point, we'd achieved quite a, you know, substantial level of success. And so obviously I was a lot more confident. again, it's not something I probably didn't think about too much. It just felt natural to do it that way.
Like, I noticed when you get to the aughts and things that your voice, you're actually doing more of the kind of 1980s metal voice. Like it gets gruffer in some places, obviously not uniform. And by the time we get to the stuff we've actually covered on here, you're working more at the bottom of your range. But it seems that, did you feel like your range got wider, got high, you were able to get higher by the late 80s? And
it's one of those things, you know, you learn to use what you have to maximize what you have. I started with the Mission. I wasn't a particularly good singer. I don't think I have a particularly unique voice. What I mean by that is someone like Bob Dylan or Morrissey or Bjork or Susie or Robert Smith, for instance, who voices, you know, polarize. People love them or, you know, they don't like them. My voice is kind of like a Bono or a Dave Gann. It's a good voice. I can sing. I know I can sing really well. I've learned how to sing really well, but I still don't feel like it's a particularly unique voice.
You can do other, you mentioned Robert Smith, like, was it Sour Puss that you added on to the Best Of? That was when Craig left. That could be Robert Smith. Was that a conscious Love Cats sort of?
No, not really. I think where I got that song from particularly was actually Sly and the Family Stone. It was just something a bit more playful. It just ended up being more like The Cure than it did Sly and the Family Stone.
Sure. That's just, yeah, by the singing. Yeah.
Obviously, Sour Puss, Love Cats, you know, yes, it's playful. I guess it's got that element to it, which makes it easily comparable.
Let me try to see if I can find one little bit in the first verse. So it's, I'm feeling true to the written word. Is it because you're echoing, you know, that it's a hit on the drums there? But like, you know, as far as the syntax, there's no reason to the would be the point that you really spike, but it totally works.
I'm not really conscious of it. It's just, you know, I didn't sit down and think, okay, that has to be more pronounced, you know.
No, it's just interesting what the voice naturally does when you're in that situation and what feels that you're following the music. You know, it doesn't have to obey what you would emphasize if you were reciting free verse or prose. Just the fact that you're, it's to me or for me, you know, that's a weird. I've had this argument with other people in my bands where I feel the need to emphasize in the lyrics, you know, at least keep the rhythm such that if you were just saying the words, then it would still be the same words emphasized, if that makes sense. It depends. If you slow things down, then it sort of dilutes that effect anyway. So if you stand firm and proud, like if you say it like that, like firm and proud have to be, but if you slow it down enough, you stand firm and like you could emphasize anything you want because it's already become something less natural. And so I think that's what's going on with the for me, that it's become an instrument, the me. It's no longer just a word.
Yeah. It becomes a hook line. There's the line where everybody sings along when we play it live, you know, that's the line.
The last song I picked, I guess before we hit this, do you want to say a little about the overall career arc of the band? So the Mission kind of had its most commercially successful work by the late 80s, early 90s, got a little more stylistically various, a little more overt T-Rex kind of chicanery in the early 90s albums. I really enjoy that period. We're not hearing anything off that here. But we did mention the Sour Puss. That was sort of the tail end of that. But then the band has broken up a couple times and you were doing solo stuff. And do you want to say a little bit about kind of what you've been up to? I know you did for instance, a just guitar instrumental against strings and piano album. These other little things that you're doing?
Whilst I was also finishing writing my book, my autobiography, I also wrote and recorded the music for a Brazilian stage play, which was a very, very interesting process to me because writing music to support as opposed to writing music that demands your attention, you know, it's a totally different concept. Also, writing for the stage as opposed to film, for instance, film is finite. You know, there's a length of time. You know, a scene runs a finite length of time. Whereas a stage play, you know, that can be different tempos every night, depending on the actors on the stage, you know, and how they're feeling and how their delivery. So there has to be some flexibility built into the music. There has to be a lot of space for them to deliver the lines. You know, the music has to be secondary, you know, to what's going on stage. That in itself was an interesting concept for me to deal with, because I'd never worked with music in that sense before. But I thoroughly enjoyed it, and it was actually quite therapeutic to go and spend, you know, a few, I'd get up in the morning and I would spend the mornings writing, and I would go and spend the afternoons in the studio making this very, very, I mean, it was restricted to acoustic guitar, violin and piano. And I wrote for the piano and violin, even though I could play piano myself. I'm not a great player. So I would actually write and play the left hand, and then I would write and play the part with the right hand. And, you know, the timings of things would be really, I mean, really quite radical. And the person I got to play the piano, my friend James Bacon, he's an extraordinary piano player. And he managed to learn all these pieces and play them in with a proper piano, play them in one take. Which, you know, took him a lot of practice. His admission was that, you know, quite a few of these pieces were actually very, very good piano exercises. I was like, okay, cool, that was good. But, I didn't write them, you know, as piano exercises. I just wrote them as pieces of music that I thought would work for the play. But, yeah, it was good. I enjoyed it. It's another string to my bow, I guess.
Yeah, are you doing any production or any other kind of side projects or things remotely over the internet with people? Any other stuff in your, you know, since the mission is not so constant at this point?
I've been involved with Michael Siravolo, who is the CEO of Schecter Guitars. He's did his own album entitled Beauty in Chaos, which is a collective. He's you know, obviously being CEO of Schecter Guitars, he knows a lot of people. So he managed to get quite a cast together to record an album and various singers. So I did a couple of tracks for that with him, collaborated the lyrics and the vocals. Other than that, you know, I spent time writing the book, and I'm now going out on tour in Europe. This starts next Monday, 57-date tour in just over two and a half months, which is quite hectic.
And is there another mission album in the works?
I'm starting to feel the itch to go in the studio and make some music. What it will end up being, I have no idea at this point, whether it'll be solo, whether it'll be mission, or whether it'll be, you know, something else altogether. No, there is no plans for the mission to make another record at this point. And I have said in the past that if we never do make another record, then I would be quite happy for another Fall from Grace to be, you know, our final album. I think it's, as I said earlier, I think it's a very, very strong album, consistent album all the way through. That the same can't be said for most of our other albums, you know, sadly. I think there's always tracks that I would tend to skip. But, I mean, the mission will tour again. I think we have plans to tour again next year to go out and play some shows. We haven't played since 2017, so, you know, it'll be time. It'll be, you know, 3 years down the line. So, you know, we're well aware. We're one of those bands that, you know, people come to see us, you know, and the currency is nostalgia. We're aware of that. People prefer to hear the old songs than us play a bunch of new ones. That's the same for most bands.
Of course. Why people have heard of you in the first place. So if ever you get resentful of their past hits, well, like, this is why I get to make new music and anybody will listen to it because of the, yeah.
I think you still need to make it interesting for yourself. You know, I like to learn a lot more songs than we need and then be able to change the set around every night. I like to do that. Keeps the band on the toes, keeps the audience on their toes, and, you know, makes life a little more interesting for us.
Well, speaking of old songs, so I will link people on the web to your 2016 single version of Marianne, your solo version. And this, what we're going to hear to close out here is, I guess, the B-side of that, My Love Will Protect You.
Well, it was a double A-side.
Okay, double A-side.
My Love Will Protect You. It was actually, I was in Argentina a few years ago playing a show, and I was approached by this actor who's also a musician. And he did an album where he collected lyrics written by homeless kids. They had an area where homeless kids could congregate during the day, and they would be taught arts, you know, how to paint, how to write poetry, how to sing, how to play guitar. So the album was released. He got a bunch of people. Damien Rice was included on the first one. And they actually raised quite a lot of money in Argentina. So he did a second album and asked me to contribute a song. So the lyrics were actually written by a 16-year-old homeless girl in Buenos Aires, which I took and adapted and wrote the tune for and the music. And so I did the song for the second album release, again, which proceeds went to providing these centers for homeless people, homeless kids in Buenos Aires.
Well, very nice. Here's My Love Will Protect You. Thank you so much for doing this.
My pleasure.
If there is anything that scares you, I'll be by your side to protect and hold you. With my sweet chants, I will banish your fears, so you can close your eyes and drift away and slumber deep in sleep. The sleep of angels, my angel child, my love will protect you. If the storm brings howling winds and driving rain, afraid, 'cause I will bring the sun again. I'll dispel the clouds, 'cause your love inspires me. And when I sing my song, you'll sing along, and I'll be strong. There'll be nothing wrong with you, my angel child, my love will protect you, my love will protect you.
Thanks so much to Wayne and to Shauna McLarnon for making that interview happen. Wayne is right now promoting a European solo tour. You can find information about that and other things at themissionuk.com. So I had heard of The Mission UK while I was in college, but don't know if I'd ever heard of any of their songs. It was a really fun immersion, some really good 80s vibes, and it was great to then read Salad Days, his autobiography, where he really gets into how much influence, for instance, T-Rex had on him. These common 60s, 70s musical starting points just make it much more clear what he's actually trying to do. My next interview will be with John Kolpitz, an amazing drummer. His professional name is Kid Millions. He plays as Man Forever, plays in a New York space rock band called Oneida. So some cool, largely instrumental jazz rock stuff, but he does have Laurie Anderson and Yo La Tengo as guests on his most recent album. We're going to hear the two tracks that they are on, so come back for that at nakedlyexaminedmusic.com. And thanks to everybody that supports me at patreon.com/nakedlyexaminedmusic. You can easily be one of those supporters. Just go there and do it. I'm getting some advertising now, so that seems like it's going to be enough motivation to keep posting these every other week, but that's not really yet paying for my time, so I really appreciate if you could go and support if you do not already. And the added bonus of doing that is you won't have to hear me read any more ads. I also want to call attention to my Pretty Much Pop podcast. We just did our first music episode on that, since that's a fun discussion roundtable where we can be less specific. It's a very different format than what you're hearing here. You can find that at prettymuchpop.com. I hope your fall is kicking off well. Keep on musicking. This is Mark Lintzmeyer signing off.
Maria.